Got to continue to push in faith, and I'm going to minister. I ministered this a while ago, but I want to minister it again so we get it down pat. Because what you're about to step into, you want to have God on your side. Amen. You want to walk in His wisdom and in His knowledge. So welcome to this morning to New Heart Worship Center. 17888 South Edgelawn Drive, Suite 1757. Headquarters of Global Apostolic Prophetic International Ministries. It's called GAPIM, G-A-P-I-M, GAPIM. We're standing in the gap in nations. And so this is, in fact, I just sent my paperwork off to incorporate Global Apostolic Ministries. This will accomplish, will be a covering for ministers around the world to come to be under the covering, to fellowship together, to cross-pollinate. As I said, my assignment is not just to be a pastor in this church, but my assignment is to the nations. I've been assigned to 8 nations so far.
Amen.
Amen. To build churches, to help build churches, to bring prophetic teaching, deliverance teaching, healing, apostolic impartations, ordinations, the whole gamut. I'm going to be traveling the world for a global harvest. It comes from a prophetic word that was spoken 5-6 years ago by a prophet that came to the house and said God wanted me to come up with a 5-year strategic global plan, and He was sending me out to nations to see what would be needed and required to help them, to train them. And I've been to places and I can see there's great needs of equipment and overhead projectors and books and materials and Bibles and just impartations and teaching. So we're getting ready to launch out this year, not just in Aurora, but we are a global ministry. We're ready to go throughout the earth, for the end time harvest is ready. The apostles are ready, or been getting ready. At least I've been getting ready. I've got other apostle friends that we commanded to go into the gym for the last 2 years to get ready for the push. Get ready. You got to have strength, a physical strength to do what needs to do to bring in all the souls that God wants to bring into the kingdom. So we're going to hit the ground running. You know, we've been in the place of Lodibar, the place of the cave of Adullam, hiding out, getting refreshed. Now we need to launch out and begin to launch out. I don't know why I'm speaking this, but I feel that the Lord, we need to begin to launch out. If you are on my Facebook page, I did a post from the Commander-in-Chief to the Army of God. It's time to be victorious. The opponents will be fierce. They will not quit. They will not stop. But God said, we have the victory, and we will not stop until we get the victory. He says, so get ready to go forth, arise, the army of God. There is a call. Let me just begin to prophesy. I'm speaking this prophetically. There's a call and a prophetic alert out right now. We are to pray and intercede for the next 7 months, the next 3 months, until November at least. Hell has released everything it can release into the earth right now. There are fights and wars and racial wars and things going in nations, just stuff that I never heard of. All of a sudden, it just exploding, like pimples exploded on somebody's face, and they're killing in Kenya, they're killing in Nigeria, they're killing in Cameroon, they're shooting in South Africa, and everything is exploding. And so the enemies are pushing everything he can against nations with false advertisement, false news media, false fake pictures of stuff that took 5 years ago that took place. Now they're trying to bring it up and say it's happening now, and they're trying to incite the people with civil war, civil unrest, tribal warfare, racism, everything the enemy can throw, because his time is short. So just be aware, this is not a time for you to be lax, lazy, and complacent. It's a time now to get ready, put your armor on, put your helmet on, put your breastplate on, put your sword, get your sword, start speaking the word, don't sit there, be quiet. You got to rise and begin to go forth. So I'm speaking this even as those are watching. This is not my message, but this is what I feel the Lord wants the world, the people to know, that it's time to rise up. It's time to accelerate. It's time for quantum movement, quantum acceleration. Just a movement. Acceleration means to speed up quickly. It just, boom, you just take off and then you accelerate. So it's a time to begin to possess the earth. The kingdoms of the world shall become the kingdoms of our Lord. Amen. We will win this battle. Amen. Corruption is being dealt with in the earth. I've been prophesying for 3 weeks. I've been attacked twice in my sleep because I'm talking about corruption, how the enemy is trying to devalue the believer, trying to devalue mankind, trying to make greed and fraud and corruption in political arenas, in the judicial system, in the legislative system, in governments and states and governments, and the pedophiles and the uncleanness that is vomiting up out of the earth. God wants to deal with it once and for all with the consuming fire of God that is being released to burn up the dross, to burn up the sin, to burn up the corruption in the earth. He's burning it up. There's a shaking. That volcano in Hawaii is not, it says first the natural, then the spiritual. That volcano is erupting hot lava. And I'm telling you, there's a spiritual eruption about to take place.
Amen. Amen.
A hot fire of God,
yes,
on our enemies, on the wicked. So get ready, get ready, get ready. And in fact, you should be ready because God has already prepared you. Amen. And for those watching this, the people that I minister here in Aurora, they're mature, seasoned saints that know how to fight. Amen. They don't take no mess off no devils. Amen. They know how to handle themselves in the close quarters. Amen. Hand-to-hand combat. Praise God. Well, at least I'm teaching some of them. Some of them still got to grow a little bit, but we'll get there. Amen. Praise God. Well, I want to talk about this morning the treasures of silver and gold.
Okay.
The treasures of silver and gold. We know that people like gold and like silver. In fact, that's the war. The war even now in nations right now. There is a financial war, an economic war. They're getting rid of this, what we call fiat, F-I-A-T, paper, fiat money. All these nations, America included, Japan, Germany, everybody printed paper money with nothing backing it. Just monopoly money. Let's just print it and say, you know, to keep our economies going. Well, every nation right now, they're swiftly and going about buying up gold, every what kind of gold they can get their hands on, and silver, and getting rid of American dollars and getting rid of paper money, have a gold backing, a gold standard, going back to the gold standard. If you look at history, John F. Kennedy was killed because he wanted to bring the gold standard back, and they assassinated him. They didn't want the wicked, the rich, the greedy, the 1% does not want money to go gold back. They want to be able to control the finances of nations. They want to be able to print all the money they can want to print, and there's nothing backing it. So we're going to talk about the treasures of gold, but that's not the thing. You'll see what it is. Ezekiel chapter 20. I'll read this. It says verse 41 through 45 says, "I will accept you and your sweet savior when I bring you out of the people and gather you out of the countries wherein you have been scattered, and I will be sanctified in you before the heathen." This is God speaking to Israel. Israel, they went into captivity, and the guy said, "I'm going to be sanctified. I'm going to bring you back." They came back in 1948. Israel became a nation. They're still coming back to Israel now from around the earth. "And you shall know that I am the Lord when I shall bring you into the land of Israel, into the country which I lifted up my hand to give it to your fathers. And there shall you remember your ways and all your doings where you have been defiled. And you shall loathe yourselves in your own sight for all the evils that you have committed." God said, "I'm going to bring you and I'm going to bless you so much that you're going to loathe the very way you acted. You're going to loathe the very perversion you went into. You're going to loathe being homosexual. You're going to loathe being lesbian. You're going to loathe being adulterous. You're going to loathe aborting babies. You're going to loathe what you did because I'm going to bring you back to in your own sight for all the evils that you've done. And you shall know that I am the Lord." That's getting ready to happen right now. "When I have wrought with you my name's sake, not according to your wicked ways." God said, "I don't deal with your wicked ways, nor according to your corrupt doings. O house of Israel, saith the Lord God. I'm not going to deal with that because of your wicked ways. Where did I go now? 38. He said, I will purge out from among you the rebels. He said, I'm going to separate the wheat from the tares. And them that transgress against me, I will bring them forth out of the country where they sojourn. They shall not enter into the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord. God said, you're going to know that I'm God because I'm separating out of the house of God. I'm not going to let them come in to be a part of Israel. As for you, O house of Israel, thus saith the Lord God, go you serve everyone his idols. And hereafter also, if you will not hearken unto me, but pollute ye my holy name no more with your gifts and with your idols. He said, I'm going to separate myself from you. You want to go and serve your idols? Go serve your idols. For in my holy mountain, in my house of God, there shall be holiness in the house of God. In the mountain of the height of Israel, saith the Lord God, there shall all the house of Israel, all of them in the land, serve me. Not serve anybody else, but serve me. There will I accept them, and there will I require your offerings and the first fruits of your oblations with all your holy things. So God said, there's going to be a separation. The prophet talks about a separation of the goat nations and sheep nations. God said, I'm going to separate the rebels out of the midst of you. There's going to be a pure, holy church that God's going to have. He said, the rest of them, if you want to go do it with your idols, go deal with your idols. He's not mad if you want to go to hell. Don't bother God. It's your choice. If you want to go there, go there. So he's talking about redemption and salvation. Redemption and salvation. He said, I will bring you, in Ezekiel 20, verse 35, he said, I will bring you into the wilderness of the people, and I will plead with you face to face. God always puts you in a wilderness position so he can deal with you. He said, I'm going to come face to face. I'm going to come in your dreams. I'm going to come with visions. I'm going to speak to your heart. I'll put you in a tough spot, but I'm going to speak to you. You're going to know it's me. Like as I pleaded with your fathers in the wilderness of the land of Egypt, so will I plead with you, said the Lord God. I will cause you to pass under the rod, and I will bring you into the bond of the covenant. I will cause you to pass under the rod. Now this is what this prophetically, what is the scripture is symbolically saying. The Lord extending his rod as his sheep pass under the staff for evaluation. In the same way, we as the body of Christ pass under his staff during this season, as described in Leviticus 27, verse 3. God gave them let me just read this. In Leviticus 27:32, he says, and concerning the tithe of the herd and the flock, even whatsoever pass under the rod, the tenth shall be holy unto the Lord. So what the shepherd would do is when it came time for accounting and to inspect his sheep, he would count every tenth sheep belonged to the Lord. The sheep would pass under the rod. He would count one, two, he'd strike one, two, three, four, five, ten. Take that one. And God said, no matter what number ten was, whether it was crippled, whether it was whatever it was your best sheep, it belonged to me. That's my tithe. You were to give me the tithe. So you're passing under the rod of God, under the covenant. He said, I'm going to cause you to pass under the rod as I evaluate you, and then I'm going to make a covenant with you. Okay. Now, when you're in a covenant with God, you're made now. It's made. It's all over now once you're in the covenant. Once you got to sign the contract, it's all said and done. So here, silver in the Bible symbolizes redemption. It also symbolizes knowledge. The knowledge of the Lord. Redemption. Isaiah 11:2 says, and the spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, and the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. So silver in the Bible, when you hear about it, it symbolizes knowledge. And I'm talking about the treasures of silver and gold, because knowledge is like silver. It's very precious. Proverbs 2 verse 3 to 6 says, this is wisdom talking. You say, well, I like silver and gold, but you don't want physical silver and gold more than you want spiritual treasures. Say, wisdom is talking in Proverbs chapter 3. This is wisdom. I'm going to read verse 1. It said, my son, forget not thy law, let thy heart keep my commandments, for length of days and long life and peace shall they add to thee. Let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them around thy neck. Write them upon the table of thy heart. Write them on the table of your heart. Too many right now in the body of Christ are running around with iPads and cell phones with the Bible on it instead of writing down, because the word gets into your heart by writing it down. That's the quickest way. Your word will not get into your heart, hallelujah, by you with an iPad. You got to write it. How many know when you write it, you remember it more than when you don't? That's a teacher here. She'll tell you, she said, I want y'all to write this stuff down because I want to see if you know it.
Yeah.
And so he would tell them to write the word down. Wisdom says, write it down. Put them around your neck. If you go to Israel, the Jews had a little front, little thing with the scriptures in it, and they'd hang on their forehead, or they would write it and put it in a little tube and hang it around their neck, the word of God. They would write it. He said, write it down and put it on the table of your heart. So to get the word in you, you got to write it. See, a lot of times we just read it. But sometimes you need to write it to get it down, on the table. And then you can go back and refresh yourself and look at it. But nowadays, you got iPads and that thing. People are not really getting the word. They can't even speak the word. You talk to some of them, you say, what church did you go to? Didn't they teach you anything over there? But I want you to see this. He said, this is wisdom talking. So shall thou find favor and good understanding in the sight of God and man. Trust in the Lord with all thy heart. Lean not to your own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. I'm in chapter 3. Where am I at? I saw it being 2. I'm going. I'm flying now, Bill. Well, let's do this. It's just as good as easy. All right. 2:1. It says, my son, if you will receive my words and hide my commandments with thee, still right on the table of your heart, so that thou incline your ear to wisdom and apply your heart to understanding. Yea, if thou criest after knowledge and lift up thy voice for understanding. I need my wife to look at this because I don't know if them daughter them on the highway. So, see who called. Anyway, verse 3 says, yea, if thou criest after knowledge and lift up thy voice for understanding, if thou seekest her as silver and search for her as hid treasures. If you seek after wisdom and knowledge as silver. If thou seekest her for silver as silver and searchest for her as hid treasures, then thou shalt understand and fear the Lord, Isaiah 11 verse 2, and find the knowledge of God. And for the Lord giveth wisdom, out of his mouth cometh knowledge and understanding. So God is the one that gives us knowledge and understanding. You can have multiple millions of dollars and still don't know how to handle it. If you don't have God's knowledge on how to handle that money, it'll go, you'll lose it. If you don't have his understanding. Treasures of silver and gold. Yeah, it's nice. I like to have some gold bars in my possession, but there's going to be some people after them gold bars.
Oh, yeah.
I got to learn how to keep it. Okay, Lord, what do you want me to do? How do I handle this? What am I supposed to do for this? So there's a knowledge of the Lord, and then there's a knowledge of the world. The knowledge of the world is idolatry, spiritual adultery. James 3:14 says, but if you have bitter envy and strife in your hearts, glory not, lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. So that's how the flesh works. It becomes earthly, carnal, sensuous, your emotions, your smell, your taste, your touch, and then the devil gets in it. And you become crackhead. Dope head, whatever. It says this is not from God. God's wisdom is, if you read James, is gentle and peaceable, easily being treated. God's wisdom is different from the man's wisdom. Man's wisdom is devilish. So there's a knowledge of the word and a knowledge of God. But you got to have the knowledge of the world also with the knowledge of God. Point in case, I talked about it last week, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Daniel said, I'm not going to eat the king's food. Come back 10 days, find out, see who's the best, who know. They took Daniel and them into captivity and taught them their ways. Yeah. Daniel learned how they operated. He had to learn their language. He had to learn their math. He had to learn all their stuff. But he was smart because God gave him supernatural knowledge and wisdom for hard sayings. Yeah. So he learned their system. And as I said last week, when he learned their system and the king found out he knew how to interpret the dreams and stuff, he made him the second president, the president of over all the presidents. Now, let me understand. Now, he came from another tribe. He come, he's a Jew. Now, you're going to put him over us? That's racism. That's, and they got jealous. They got mad. And they concocted and conspired to catch him. You said, we can't get him other than him defile his God. We got to catch him in something else. And that's how they caught him. But God, but see, Daniel got knowledge of the fear of the Lord. Yeah. Daniel said, I got this knowledge that if I mess up, you can kill me, but I got to serve him. Amen. And so Daniel found out that they wrote against him. He said, let me open up my window and do what I'm supposed to do. I'm going to pray 3 times a day anyway. Amen. Because I got a fear of God. I fear God, know that I fear these old crazy men over here trying to get me and trap me and put me in trouble. Yeah. And because of that, God saved him, and the supernatural fear of God hit the kingdom. Yeah. And the king said, anybody mess with Daniel, your house is going to be a dung heap. I'm going to kill your mama, your daddy, your kids, your dog, your cat. All of them going to be burned up in the fire. Y'all mess with Daniel no more. See, let God fight your battles. Don't even worry about it. When God gets through, folks will do that. In fact, he said in Haggai, silver and gold is mine. I got all the silver and gold. So God's speaking that we're going to pass under the rod. In Jeremiah 33, the promises are being fulfilled right now. These are the promises of God. I want you to just see the Jeremiah 33, 16. In the cities and the mountains of the mountains, in the cities of the vale, in the cities of the south, and in the land of Benjamin, in the places about Jerusalem, in the cities of Judah, shall the flocks pass again under the hands of him that telleth them, saith the Lord. In other words, they're going to pass under the rod of the covenant. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, I will perform that good thing I have promised unto the house of Israel and to the house of Judah. In those days, at that time, I will cause the branch of righteousness, Jesus Christ, to grow up into David, and he shall execute judgment in righteousness in the land. And in those days shall Judah be saved, and Jerusalem shall dwell in safety. And this is the name wherewith you shall be called, the Lord our righteousness. We are walking in that place right now. God is releasing the Judah. He said the branch of Judah, the tribe of Judah, the throne of David shall not cease. Praise and worship shall never cease. Judah shall plow. Judah goes forth. Judah is the key to spiritual warfare. Do you know that the second heaven right now is shaken? That the princes and powers of darkness are shaken? Do you understand that we have been beating them up in so much in prayer and decrees and prophetic decrees that now they're afraid? Now we're thwarting their plans on the earth itself. See, it's easier to beat the devil in the air than when he gets on the ground. Then we got to deal with him in the ground with these crazy homosexual parades and all this crazy stuff. It's better to bind him in the heavenlies and keep him in the heavenlies than again, it's better to keep a fly out before he gets in the house. Then you got to chase him all over the house. You can't sleep until you get the fly out. Be running in the kitchen, covering up all the food. Fly in the house. We have a choice, gold or wisdom. The corrupt in America right now have chosen money and greed and gold and silver. And they don't want the middle. They're just about getting rid of the middle class. The poor man can't make it and the middle class can't make it. But God's about to change this whole scenario around. Amen. The poor, the rich are going to become the poor. Amen. You can't beat a poor man down no farther than what he's doing. If you're poor, it can't go nowhere but up. We ain't got nowhere to go but up. Truth. Wisdom is gold, symbolizes truth, something precious, righteousness, right standing with God. The glory of God is a symbol of gold. So God said, I'm going to give you the treasures of silver and gold, my righteousness. I want to give you my truth. I want to give you the glory of the Lord. I want you to carry the glory. I want you to give you the spiritual gold. Now in the Bible, there's another symbol for brass. Brass is another metal. It equals the word of God or the word of man. Brass symbolizes judgment, fake, man's tradition, self-glorification. There's a scripture talks about you pray and it seems like your heaven is as brass. I mean, it ain't no prayers getting through. Amen? Because your rebellion, your stubbornness, your disobedience, man's tradition. 1 Corinthians 13:1, Paul says, though I speak with tongues of men and of angels and have not love, I become a sounding brass. Fleshly, carnal, sounding brass. And you hear a lot of sounding brass coming out of our TV and mainstream news, and these knuckleheads getting up there trying to quote the scripture, and they don't even know Jesus. They don't even know him. They don't know him. They ain't even talk to him. You don't even know half of them. The humble never stumble. And this comes, I'm teaching you this, I'm trying to instruct you in this, even if you become a millionaire, even if you got thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars, you still have to walk in humility. Amen. You have to reflect Christ with this. I want to get this down in you because that is the key to revival. It's the key to blessing. It's one thing now, you're in the church right now, we say God bless you and Jesus loves you and we'll pray for you and heal you and deliver you. But now God's going to put some money in our pocket. Amen. You can't tell people go away and come back again. Uh-huh. You're going to have to take them through the process and help them how you can help them. And if the problem is too big, then you give it to Jesus. Yeah, right. And let him solve the problem. But we have to do the work. 2 Chronicles 12, verse 5 through 7. Then came Shimei, the prophet, to Rehoboam. Now remember, the kingdom was split because of Solomon's sin, his idolatry, all the wives he had, they turned his heart away from God. The man that had all the understanding, the man that had all the wisdom, we're going to see this, he messed up. And the princes of Judah, and they were gathered together in Jerusalem because of Shishak. And said unto them, thus saith the Lord, you have forsaken me, therefore I also left you in the hand of Shishak. You want to leave me? I'll let the devil beat the tar at you. Ain't no problem. Whereupon the princes of Israel and the kings humbled themselves and said, the Lord is righteous. Yeah, we messed up. When the Lord saw that they humbled themselves, the word of the Lord came to Shimei, saying, they have humbled themselves. Therefore, I will not destroy them, but I will grant them some deliverance. Y'all see that? If you humble yourself, God will grant you some deliverance. And my wrath shall not be poured out upon Jerusalem by the hand of Shishak. I was going to use Shishak to beat the tar out of y'all. He had a big stick and he was going to kill all y'all. So I'm not going to whoop you. I'm going to let him whoop you. Yeah. He said, but when you humble yourself, I'm going to bless you. Verse 8 says, nevertheless, they shall be his servants. You're going to get some punishment that they may know that my service and the service of the kingdoms of the countries. God said, you messed up, you rebelled. I'm not going to kill you. I'm not going to let Shishak kill y'all. But you're going to serve him. And you're going to find out that serving him is much harder than serving me. And we wonder why we're in a mess in America. Because we done chose to serve the creature more than the creator. We wonder why our kids are all shot up in Chicago. Murders and gunfire. And when I was prophesying, they called me crazy, nuts, and knucklehead. When I started preaching against these gambling casinos, oh, we're going to put the casino in there, and we're going to take the money for our children's education. You just took cursed money and put it into the education system, and now you got a bunch of cursed kids. And then they ain't put the money in the education system. I went down to the casino trying to get some grant money to help us, you know, with the kids, with teaching them how to play golf and stuff like that.
No.
Oh, we give to over here. We don't give to. Okay. Not a problem. May your boat sink over there on, in the name of Jesus. And one of them did call catch fire. Don't mess with the prophet. We'll burn you up, boy. So Shishak, the king of Egypt, came up against Jerusalem and took away the treasuries out of the house of the Lord. The treasuries out of the king's house, he took all. And carried away also the shields of gold which Solomon made. Well, know what that tells me? That money will leave you. That gold and silver will leave you. Physical gold and silver, you can have it, but something's going to happen down the pike that can cause you to lose everything.
Yeah.
You can build that nice mansion if you want. The hurricane, the tornado come in and just tear it right down.
Yeah.
Nothing is guaranteed.
Right.
Instead of which King Rehoboam made shields. So Rehoboam said, I can't get the righteousness. I can't get the pure trust. I can't get gold and silver. So let me let brass, which is man's self-gratification, man's way of doing things. He said, God and took away his glory. Now I got to come up with some brass. And committed to the chairs of the chief guard that kept the entrance to the house. So we know that brass nowadays, we use brass for bullets.
Yeah. Oh, Jesus.
That's what they use brass to kill people with. Bullet shells are made out of brass.
Yep.
So if you want to make an investment, invest in the brass fields because they want to kill everybody anyway. You make a lot of money. Jesus. Ephesians says 6:16, he said, above all, taking the gold shield of faith. You know your shield of faith is made of gold. To quench the fiery darts of the wicked one. The glory of the Lord is on your shield of faith. The glory stops the fiery darts of the wicked one. Not the brass seal of self-justification. You want the gold shield. Wherewith you are able to quench the fiery darts of the wicked one. Isaiah 48 verse 4 says, because I knew you were hard-headed and obstinate, and thy neck is an iron of sinew, and thy brow is as brass. Now he's equating Israel to rebellion as brass. You're just stubborn, hard-headed, stiff neck. He said, I even from the beginning declared it unto thee. Before it came to pass, I showed it to you. Least I should say, my idol have done them, and my graven image and my molten image have commanded them. God said, I had told you from the beginning what's going to happen. Don't try to put it on, well, my idol did this and my idol did this, and your idol ain't going to do nothing. There's some poor people over in Africa right now. A lot of them, when they go to them witch doctors, they for money blessings and all that, it costs something. We're going to give you money blessings. You're going to be a millionaire, but your first child is mine. Or your wife got to be crazy. Or somebody got to be insane in your family. Jesus, they be messing folks up. They be all messed up. Or you be barren. Or you can't have no children. I was watching this one movie. The lady was pregnant for 2 years. The baby wouldn't come out. They had tied that womb up. That baby ain't coming out. No, 2 years. She had to finally break down and go to a deliverance minister and get the devil cast out of her. I prayed for over 200 women when I last trip in Nigeria. I prayed for over 200 women that wanted to be pregnant because they couldn't get pregnant. Barren. That stuff works over there. They believe in that stuff. They tie them up and bind them up. And we come to break the curses. And I had to lead them in breaking curses. And the folks got free and all that kind of stuff. You know, the Bible says we're all going to come into the unity of the faith. So even those that are not spiritually where you are, we got to go back and reach them and bring them up. So I'm not even talking about packing your bag. Jesus is coming and you're going to heaven. You got too much work to do.
Amen.
I'm teaching you so you can teach somebody else. Because you're going to get your turn to teach somebody else. God's going to make sure he puts you in a position where you got to teach somebody else. He's going to put it in. Even if you got your bad kids, he's going to make your kids turn bad so you can teach them the word of God. Silver and gold, the treasure of silver and gold is in your heart. Matthew 6:21. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. If your focus is on physical money and that, your focus should be on the love of God and the heart of God. God is releasing supernatural resources and treasures. Proverbs 13:17 says, the refining pot is for silver and the furnace for gold, but the Lord tests the heart. So quit saying, why me? He's put you in the refiner's fire. The situations that you didn't want to be in, you couldn't stand to be in, you didn't, fighting with your mate and fighting with this, God put you in the situation. Oh, Jesus, to see what you would come out to be. Amen. Will he put you in that fire? Would you come out as pure gold, or would you come out as Aaron's calf? Amen. He deals with us. We don't like it. I don't like it. I'd be looking up there. What are you doing? Anybody ever done that? Yeah. I've done it. I said, Lord, what are you doing? Why are you hitting me like that? What did I do? I didn't know that. See, your stubborn, your neck is a sinew, a stubborn self-will, and that brow, that brass is rude, a rude person. What do you have in your heart? There's a commercial used to be on, what's in your wallet?
Yeah, yeah.
God wants to know what's in your heart.
Yeah.
Many saints of the old have thrown away their prophetic destinies because they ended up despising the prophecies that they got. I got prophecies from 25, 30 years ago, you're going to be a millionaire. And every devil, poverty devil in the world, try to knock on my door.
Yeah.
He don't live here. I just let them people call me on the phone. Is Mr. Buford here? No, Mr. Buford, you got the wrong number. I don't be lying. I don't be lying. My name ain't Buford. Amen. You, evidently, you don't know me, so I'm going to click anyway. If you can't get my name right, I don't know you. Hallelujah. People have abandoned their prophecy. They despise them. They abandon them. And others have tried to keep their prophecies by fighting the good fight of faith. But when the battle became too fierce, they ran away. Because the devil's going to fight you. And when the temptation of the world came, they just left their post. AWOL. Just absent. Absent from your visions. Absent from your dreams. Absent from your prophetic word. But God is telling me this morning, he wants you to re-dream again. He wants you to see your vision again. He wants you to recast your vision. He wants you to see there's something new coming down the road. And you got to hold on to those prophetic words. Whole churches, whole movements, cities, nations, individuals walked away from the vision, abandoning their dreams. They just walked away. God wants you to claim your dreams, reclaim them, reinvigorate it. God said, my word is not void that it will return void. It's not dead. It'll accomplish that which is set to do. Where your treasure is where your heart is. Find your treasure. What did God place inside of you? Can you recognize what's on the inside of you? Where are your spiritual eyes? We can't see the invisible realm or discover our treasure if we don't know where our eyes are. God wants us to learn to dream with him and redeem the prophetic promises. Apostles Paul spoke about how God would enlighten our eyes in Ephesians 1:18. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened that you may know the hope of his calling and what the riches of his glory is. And ain't just silver and gold. There's a gold. He said, I'm looking for vessels of silver and vessels of gold. There's vessels of wood, hay, and stubble, but I'm looking for vessels of silver and gold that will go through the process of the refiner's fire, of deliverance, of being pressured, of being pounded on, being beat on, and being, so I can make you into something to serve up. I want to use you specially, amen? Special gold plates, special silver goblets. You don't pour that stuff out when you're having a barbecue. You have a fancy dinner, amen? You want to set the table. You want everything to be looking good. You don't just pour out the rest of the stuff. You get paper cups and stuff. You won't use that. Mess up my fine china and my good stuff. God is releasing resources. I'm almost done here. Well, I didn't jump off anyway. Your praise. I'm going to look at, let me. Your praise is precious. Where's the scripture at? Let me just, I gotta zip ahead. Zip, 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 zip. Zip, zip, zip. Acceleration, y'all. I'm accelerating. See, it jumped off me. You don't want to give me. Your praise is devil, you are a lie. I know another. I'm going to get him anyway. I'll get him anyway. You want to stop my show. Your praise is equal to gold. Proverbs 27:21. As a refining pot for silver and the furnace for gold, so is a man's praise. That means I don't care what kind of pressure and heat the enemy is putting on me, I still got to praise. My trials and my tests show how much praise I got. In other words, it's like gold and silver. My praise is so precious that the enemy has stopped. I had a dream one time, one of these dreams, prophetic dreams that God gave me. I was with another apostle, and we was on this hill, and there were thousands of demons coming at us, and thousands of demons coming over here, and thousands, and we both had a sword, and we had a shield up, and Jesus was standing on the side, and he said, "Now start praising." And when we started praising God, they started bloop, 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 disappearing. They just blew up like bubbles. It was gone. Your praise steals the avenger. I don't care. He looks terrible. He's growling and snarling. And you're saying, "Praise you, Jesus. Glory to God. Shut up. Praise you, Jesus." Shut up. And he blows up. Your praise is precious. Don't let your praise, let the devil steal your praise. That Job came and the devil wanted to steal. He stole everything but his praise. He tried, but he couldn't take his praise. Jesus, fall out and worship me, and I'll give you all this. No, you ain't taking my praise. It's always been about the praise. It's always been about your worship to the Lord. The devil has always fought us about worship. Let them come out of Egypt and come and worship me. No, I don't want them to come worship you. I won't keep you. They may leave me, and then I ain't got nobody to do my work. Lazy self, work your own country. Let my people go. Let them go. True wealth and riches. Here it is. 2 Chronicles verse 1. Chapter 2 Chronicles 1 verse 11. And God said to Solomon, because this was in your heart, you wanted to get wisdom and understanding, and you have not asked for riches. You didn't ask for gold. Give me a big check account. Give me $1 million in the bank. Give me all this honor. Give me the honor. Let everybody praise me when I come into the service. Everybody back up the seat part when I walk into service. The great man of God is coming to the place. You didn't ask for all of that. You didn't ask for your enemies. You don't want to kill all of you. I know I got enemies stabbing me and choking me and talking about me. Leave them alone. Let them go. He said, but you have asked for wisdom and knowledge for yourself that you may judge my people over whom I've made you king. And because you have asked for this, I'm going to give you silver and gold. I'm going to give you money. Wisdom attracts money. Wisdom attracts favor. Understanding attracts things. When you have understanding and knowledge of something, it don't cost you. So I say, I always learn how you do that. How did you do that? Oh, okay. I'll do it next time. Save me some money. I ain't got to go to the mechanic. I ain't got to go to the plumber. I ain't got to go to the air conditioning guy. I know how to do it myself. I'm going to learn how to. Hey. Amen. That ain't being cheap. That's getting smart. Yeah. Amen. That's saving some money. Amen. Yeah. Especially when you ain't got none. You know how to fight to keep it. You got to do things to keep. Some of y'all going to go with me on some of these trips to Africa. You're going to see the creativity of these people when they ain't got nothing. If you can give them just a wheelbarrow, do you know a wheelbarrow is like a car over there? You can make money with a wheelbarrow. They'll get out there and hustle and carry food and roll stuff for miles, you know, carry somebody's wood or cassava or whatever. If I can just rent a wheelbarrow for a day, I can live. A tire, anything. Just, I saw them riding a car. I wish I had that picture. I got it somewhere. That car, with no way that car was supposed to ride. It was supposed to run. I don't know how it was running. It was a bunch of metal. It was bent in half, like. And they had a pile, stuff piled on top of it. And no doors and no seat belts. And they boogieing down the road. getting where they got to get and do what they got to do. I don't care how, I didn't know how that car was running. Probably had a squirrel in a cage or something. Keep that thing going. It didn't look like nothing. That thing wasn't going to run. I'm telling you, you go over there, you will not find an auto wrecking yard. They use everything. I mean, they every piece of scrap, every tire, every nut, every bolt, they use it. True wealth and riches is important. Let's look at this. Proverbs 3, verse 14. I want you, let's talk, let's let wisdom talk a little bit here. Actually, I'm going to read Proverbs 3, 14, then we'll go to Proverbs 8. Proverbs 3, verse 13 says, happy is the man that findeth wisdom, and a man that getteth understanding, for the merchandise is better than the merchandise of silver, and the gain thereof of fine gold. She is more precious than rubies. All the things you can't desire are not to be compared to wisdom. Because the Bible says money is fleeting. Money has wings. Yeah. Say the eagle flies on Friday and he's gone on Saturday, man. You don't come back to your perch. He just flies away. Pew, 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 pew. And then you got to get up Monday morning. I know I got to go to this job because if I don't, I'll be sitting outside. Yeah. Proverbs 8. Look at Proverbs 8. I want you to see this. This is it just blessed me. I don't know. It just... Proverbs 8, verse 5. Oh, simple, understand wisdom, and you fools, be of understanding heart. Here, I will speak excellent things, and open up my lips shall be right things. For my mouth shall speak truth, and wickedness is abomination to my lips. All the words out of my mouth are righteousness. There's nothing forward or perverse in them. They are all plain to him that understandeth, and right to them that find knowledge. I mean, this is plain. Don't be unequally yoked with an unbeliever. Now, that's plain. But some people don't have understanding. And they go out and try to do it anyway. And then they wind up, as I said, married to Chucky. And they don't know. They didn't follow the instruction. Verse 10 says, receive my instruction, not silver. Quit running after money. Knowledge rather than choice gold. For wisdom is better than rubies, and all the things that may be desired are not to be compared. I, wisdom, would dwell with prudence and find out knowledge of witty inventions. Witty invention. If you seek after me, I can give you knowledge to invent stuff that nobody else invent. Amen? Amen? Man, you know what I'm talking about. Nobody even thought, oh, how do you think about that? And now you're a millionaire because you have one idea from God downloaded in you. If we can get prophetic songs from God, prophetic words from God, how come we can't get witty inventions from God? Same kingdom, same wisdom, same spirit. They say, so seek after that first. By me kings reign and princes decree justice. By me princes rule, nobles even the judges of the earth. I love them that love me, and those that seek me early find me. Riches and honor are with me. Yeah, durable riches and righteousness. Durable. Well, you know something? You ain't got to go wash it one time and it fall apart. Durable, you know, good stuff is with me. So she said wisdom is instruction. So we don't want the treasures of physical gold, even though we like having money in our wallet and in pocket, burning a hole in it, but God wants us to have understanding on how to handle it. You got to know how to handle money. You got to learn how to handle riches. You got to learn how to handle people. Just because you got, don't be arrogant because you got money. Don't be arrogant. Oh, I can buy your whole store. You know, that's arrogant. Yeah. Be humble. Yeah. Put people down. Real quickly, and I'm going to wrap this up. What'd you say? Proverbs 10? And then buy the whole store. That's right. Just be humble. They give you a bad time in the store. Just, okay, back out. And then when you come back tomorrow, say, you fired. I own this store. Now, I'm going to put some Christians in here. Your attitude wrong.
Yeah.
The wrong attitude. Proverbs 10:20 says the tongue of the just is as choice silver. And the heart of the wicked is of little worth. Let me read out the Amplified. Amplified says it this way. The tongues of those who are upright and in right standing with God are as choice silver. The minds of those who are wicked and out of harmony with God are of little value. So let them folks leave them alone. Quit trying to picket with them and fight with them on the picket line. Don't go and pick on the right line. They don't have any understanding. Leave them alone. Don't go out there and fight them. Your mind is messed up. You don't even know God. So if I'm trying to speak to you spiritual things, you can't even understand it because the carnal mind is enmity against God. So you sit there trying to argue with them folks. God said, I'll deal with them. You just share who I am. Just share who what I'm all about. Proverbs 25:11 says, of the words, fitly, a word at the right time are like a pitcher of apples of gold. 25:11, a word fitly spoken is like apples of gold and pitchers of silver. Nice, sweet words coming out of your mouth at the right time. We got golden, delicious apples. Just think of that, golden, delicious apples in a silver bowl. You know, that's fitly at the right time. Not that waxed over fruit that you got on your table. You remember when you was a kid and the people had that wax food on it and tried to bite it. You ain't bite it. That's how some Christians are. You know, they once had some fruit of the Spirit and they just waxed it over. Now you can't even touch them no more. Silver and gold. Ecclesiastes 2:8. I'm trying to zip through this. Now this is the wisest man on the earth writing all this stuff. But look what he says. Yeah, Solomon. If you read chapter 2, look at the beginning of every verse. Leviathan speaking. I said in my heart, go now, I will reprove thee with mirth, therefore enjoy pleasure, and behold, this is also vanity. I'm going to go to the club and party, 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 party. I said of laughter, I'm a good comedian to come in. I'm going to laugh myself mad. And mirth, what doeth it? I sought in my heart to give myself unto wine, yet acquainting my heart with wisdom. Yet I'm acquainting my heart with wisdom, and I'm over here tea-tipping, sipping wine. And lay hold on folly, till I might see what was good for the sons of men, which they should do under the heavens all the days of their life. I made me great works. I builded me houses. I planted me vineyards. I made me gardens and orchards and planted trees in them of all kinds of fruits. I made me pools of water and watered therewith the wood that bringeth forth trees. I got me some servants, some maidens, and I had servants born in my house. And also I had great possessions of great and small cattle above all were in Jerusalem before me. I gathered me also gold and silver and peculiar pleasures of kings and the promises. I got me singers and women singers and the lights of the son of men and musical instruments and all and that of all sorts. So I was great and increased more than all that were before me in Jerusalem. Also my wisdom remained with me. I was shocked. My wisdom still was with me. And whatever my eyes desired, I kept not. I withheld not my heart from joy, for my heart rejoiced in all my labor, and this is my portion of all my labor. Then I looked on all my works and the hands had wrought, and all the labor that I had labored to do, and behold, all was vanity and vexation of the spirit, and there was no profit under the sun. And I turned myself, and behold, wisdom and madness and folly, for what can a man do that becometh after a king? Even that which he hath already done. So here you got a billionaire that's dissatisfied. He's running everything, got everything, did everything, and it's all vanity. You see, I got drunk, I had parties, I did this, I had comedians come, they made me laugh, I did everything. I built me vineyards, built me pools, swimming pools, and all fish pools, and I just did everything. It's just all vanity. He said, verse 13, then I saw wisdom excel of folly, as far as light excel of darkness. A wise man's eyes are in his head, but a fool walketh in darkness. And I myself perceive also that one event happened to them all. Then I said in my heart, as it happened to the fool, so it will happen even to me. Fool gets buried in a box, goes 6 feet deep. You don't get buried in a box, it goes 6 feet deep. It don't matter whether you got a wooden box or a nice satin sheet box. You're still going into the box. Then I said, my heart, as it happened to a fool, it happened to me. And why was I then more? How can I be more wise? Then I said in my heart, this is also vanity. For there is no remembrance of the wise more than a fool forever, seeing that which is now in the ways, days to come, shall be forgotten. And how he dieth, the wise man, as the fool. Therefore I hated life, because work that was wrought under the sun is grievous unto me, for all is vanity and vexation of spirit. Yea, I hated my labor, which I had taken under the sun, because I should leave it to a man that shall be. Listen, I want you to see this. I hated all my labor, which I have taken under the sun, my retirement fund, my pension fund, because I should leave it to a man that shall be after me. And who knoweth whether he shall be a wise man or a fool with my stuff? Yet shall he shall rule over all my labor. When I've labored, when I've showed myself wise under the sun. This is also vanity. I'm laboring. Therefore, I went about to cause my heart to despair of all the labor that which I took under the sun. For there is a man whose labor is in wisdom and in knowledge and in equity, yet a man that doth not labor therein shall leave it for his portion. This is also vanity. For what hath a man of all his labor and of all his vexation of heart where he have labored under the sun? For all his days are days of sorrow. So there's nothing better than a man should eat and drink and make his soul joy of his labor. This I saw was the hand of God. Take time to enjoy the blessings of God. Because you don't know who's going to possess that house after you're gone. Somebody's going to have it when you're gone. I guarantee you. Hopefully, if you don't put it in trust, this is your generations can keep it. You know, we just coming to this place now. We just coming to this because we never got an inheritance from nobody. Amen. Now you're going to be able to leave an inheritance to your children's children, third and fourth generation. Amen. You want to leave something to your grandchildren. Wise man leaves inheritance to his children's children. So you don't know. So you want to train them and instruct them. But I want you to see that it's all vanity. He said, I got all of this stuff. Now here's the wise man speaking. I got billions of dollars. Gold, silver, houses, cattle, sheep, women, songs, everything. Only thing good it is, I'm doing what God wants me to do. That's the best thing. That's the best thing. Let me just enjoy what God has told me to do. And then I don't have to worry about the rest of that stuff. Because I walk uprightly in my heart. I've given alms and blessed the poor and did the things that Job did. Job got double for his trouble in his end time. Amen. Silver and gold. The treasures of silver and gold. Silver is mine. The gold is mine. Refiner's fire. And here's the last little piece here I want to say. There's no excuse for you not evangelizing and bringing souls in the kingdom. You can't use the excuse, we ain't got no money. Jesus sent his disciples out in Matthew. He said, take no gold, nor silver, nor scrip. And when he came back, he said, did you lack anything? And he said, we ain't lack nothing. You're trying to tell them, you don't need that stuff. I'm with you if you just go and do it. But then there came a time at the end, he said, now take you some money and stuff and go and preach the gospel. He was trying to show him, he said, I'm all sufficient in any situation. So don't sit back and say, well, if God would just give us some more money and we can do this and we can do that and we can do, God said, do what you can do right now.
That's it. That's right.
And then it'll be added to you.
Amen.
Amen. So that should convict all of us in here. because we ain't got no excuse. Well, when we get the money, then we can do streaming wide and do worldwide ministry and do that. But I've never let that stop me. We've been sending money to Africa. We've been Bibles. We've been people baptized. We've been doing it, helping build churches with the little stuff that we got, whatever little thing we got. So now you're going to get the big stuff, because the big stuff is coming. The little stuff, now you're getting it. So you have been redeemed. With precious silver and gold. You are, you don't look at the physical thing, because I guarantee you, when you get a lot of money, your head about explodes. You start thinking about, I'm going to buy this, I'm going to get that, I'm going to get this. You'll be up all night tossing and turning, fluffing the pillow, trying to turn. Oh man, I'm going to do that. Oh wow, ooh, I'm going to do that. I can't wait. Your imagination running wild. I'm gonna get this. I'm gonna get that. I'm gonna get this. I'm gonna do that. Oh Jesus. Oh Lord. Oh no. And you up all night trying to figure it out. You know me when you get that you know, you got that big old check coming from the IRS. Oh, I'm getting $1,800 back. And you sit there and scheme and plot, and then the refrigerator break down, car break down, everything. By the time you get that little check, it was nothing in it. Then your mama calls and say, I need a loan. Can you help me out? And we got communion. So wealth and riches is just not silver and gold. It's something else. It flees. Money flees. Yep. Amen. Give the Lord a hand, praise. Amen. Yeah, we got communion this morning. I got birthday. I got Father's Day money, and while I'm having to spend it on my grandson, he had to buy him a pair of man's size at 8 shoes. $100 for a pair of shoes. Jesus, he only 12, and he wearing a size 8 man's now. I said, "Oh God." I said, "Why are your feet so? You ain't gonna never fall down. Your feet that big." Jesus. You put on a pair of pants, and they were floods. I mean, they was, he ain't got no more clothes. Got to buy them all new clothes this next semester. It's just, Jesus. She bought him two pair of shoes. He wear one pair of shoes twice, and they were too small.